Welcome to Film in Minnesota. I'm your host, Alan Tracy.
And I'm Rahana Power.
And today we have David Mayer with us. Hello, David.
Hello. Thank you for having me on. I'm very honored to be here amongst so many other great filmmakers and actors you've had on the show. So I'm truly honored to be here.
Well, we are really excited to have you here and get to know you a little bit. And we have so many questions for you today when it comes to the film world, why we're all here. But before we jump into that, I feel like we really need to get to know each other on a totally different level and basis. So we're going to ask you our fun question. David, can you tell us something fun or interesting about yourself, like a special skill or talent that you might have that others might be super aware of? Maybe you've kept it secret this whole time and you're finally divulging it on this podcast.
This one isn't really a secret, but it's kind of unusual. So in high school and college, I played trumpet in the jazz band. And while in college, we were touring in Europe and we're at the Montreux Jazz Festival. And we got a call from someone in the Clarence Gatemouth Brown, his band, and he's opening for B.B. King at the Montreux Jazz Festival. And wow. Four of their players couldn't make it to the show. And so they needed some substitute players to fill in. And so me and three other of my bandmates sat in
wow,
to open for B.B. King at the Montreux Jazz Festival.
That's incredible.
It was kind of a matter of being in the lucky and being in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
Because wow. Yeah, it was a pretty amazing experience.
And you were in Europe?
Yeah. Yeah. Our college jazz band, University of Minnesota Morris.
Okay.
At the time went to Europe probably every few years. I forget how often, maybe like every 3 years or 4 years, something like that. So maybe it was every other year. It might've been that. And then we went to New Orleans in the other years oftentimes. So
that sounds wow. Amazing. Both of those sound amazing, but B.B. King, I mean, that's like a huge experience, that like a once in a lifetime thing.
Yeah, absolutely. It was wild. So
yeah,
I guess one small claim to fame.
Yeah, that wouldn't be a secret you keep, I guess.
No.
Yeah,
I would have that plastered everywhere.
It doesn't come up often in casual conversation, though. So thanks for giving me the opportunity.
Absolutely. You're a lot more humble than I am. That would be my opener in every conversation, and be like, I played with B.B. King before, but nice to meet you.
Yes. Yeah. Well, it's not like I, you know, tried out and made it in the band. We just happened to kind of be there, and we were
right,
at least marginally capable. So.
Did you get to like talk to him afterwards? Did he like?
Well, we got to. I mean, we got to hang out backstage, and like, we wanted to play it cool, so we weren't like, you know.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to, you know, we got at least to see him back there, but it wasn't like a, I don't know. It was musicians, you know, back there, so we don't want to be like all up in his business before the show.
That's really respectful of you guys.
But definitely after the show, right?
Yeah.
I'll just keep harping on it. Anyways, David, you're a director, right? And producer? Or what are your roles really?
I don't know. Like, I guess filmmaker is probably the best title, because I try to do a little bit of everything. Mm-hmm. Except maybe prefer not to do much acting anyway, but everything else.
Yeah, I'll help you change that.
mostly. Yeah. I mean, I've directing is probably, I'm definitely something I've done, but yeah, producing, because often I just produce my own stuff with a couple friends of mine, Adam Overland and Rebecca Malmstrom. And I've done a little bit of collaborating with some other teams with the writing and a little bit of just kind of helping out on set and stuff like that. But
cool. Yeah. So
but I also, like, you know, do that editing and some visual effects and, you know,
oh wow,
but
so everything
kind of, yeah, nothing great, but I can do a lot of it.
Cool. So how did you get started with like directing, or what was your start? Was it directing or was it producing? What was it? Was it a PA?
it started probably about 1994, 1995-ish in high school with me and my friends. We would just make little short films on a weekend for fun. And it was very, I mean, the technology then was so bad compared to what we have now. I mean, it was with the family camcorder and we had to shoot in sequence. So, you know, if you want to do a scene with multiple different shots, you had to figure out what you're going to do and do it in sequence. And then if you'd had a bad take, you could rewind a little bit and then tape over. But if you did that too many times and you have to go back a little bit further each time, you'd end up having to redo the take before that because you'd lose, you know, too much of the preceding shot. And then initially we'd just play music live on set, like from a CD player for our background music. And then eventually we started using where we would put the audio from the, what we had filmed, record in a stereo VCR, but record it in mono. So we put the audio in one channel and then the music in the other channel, just using totally not no rights to use it, but just using, you know, movie soundtrack CDs and stuff like that.
So are we talking, is this VHS or?
Well, yeah, I mean, the camcorders.
Mini DV or?
They were, yeah, probably the, whatever Sony cameras were using, like digital 8 or something along the, or 8mm video cameras at the time. Yeah. And then we would, you know, eventually get them on VHS. And they, you know.
The good stuff.
Yeah. It was just, you know. you know, we would just show them to our family and friends and stuff like that. But we got more and more elaborate. And in the summer after I graduated, we kind of did our biggest film, which was called Visitor, about a alien who came to Earth and went on a killing spree. And the hard-boiled police officers and detectives who went on the chase to defeat the alien. And it was about 40 minutes long, and we filmed it, filmed it over the course of the summer. It, you know, made our own alien costume.
Wow.
That's awesome.
How'd that look?
Pretty bad. but we, as we, so we had it mostly completed, and we had some friends over some evening in the summer, and one of my friends, Nick Sheminsky, put it on and went up along a road by my house, which was kind of undeveloped at the time. They were kind of like in the bushes in this alien costume. And then cars would kind of slow down. So we were going to just drive up there and kind of watch the reactions to cars going by. And as he was walking back towards my house, we see a police car go by. And shortly after that, about, I don't know how many, several police cars were driving by where he had been, like shining the lights into the bushes and high up in the trees, like looking for whatever had been reported to the police at that time.
That's hilarious. Like, how many people do you think to this day are like, no, I swear I saw it, you guys. Like,
it's real. I don't know. I would love to know. I would really love to know. I'd like to hear what, you know, call came into the police.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, it's phenomenal. Not like today where everything's documented online and you can probably find a record somewhere, but
this is like zoom in on the picture.
Yeah. Exactly. And then they didn't, you know, they didn't have a, you know, their cell phone with them to take footage of whatever it was. So,
right.
Yeah. Back in olden times.
Yeah. We're talking, that sounds like 80s, 90s maybe. So,
Yep. Yeah. That would have been probably, mid 90s.
Okay.
So, I don't know how many we made, probably, 10 to 20. It's like, and also I don't know where, like some of them we were just kind of screwing around and I don't know if I'd call it a short film, but then some of them clearly were. So I don't know. It's hard to say what's what, but.
Well, if you're hitting that 40 minute mark, that's kind of flirting with feature length there. So, you know.
Yeah. That one was probably a bit much, but.
Is it a lot of like the Blair Witch kind of look like?
No, we tried to make it look fairly decent with the camera that we had. And so it wasn't, I mean, it, it, I mean, it's just not a good, you know, the video cameras back then were not good, and a lot of limitations. And, you know, it's all just high school kids playing, you know, every character in the thing. So it's pretty obvious that it's not a legitimate thing. But
do you still have those tapes?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. One of my friends, Greg Kiso, has he works in advertising and makes commercials and things like that. And and he put together a few, this is quite a while ago now, but he put together a DVD that compiled kind of everything all together onto a DVD. So we've got it preserved.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I love that. So knowing, like, you've been doing this for a while and like really having fun with it. So who like inspires you when it comes to your filmmaking today versus maybe back then even?
Well, I mean, it's, I don't know how many people say this, but certainly George Lucas and Star Wars was a big influence on me growing up. And wanted me to, you know, get into possibly doing something with filmmaking. Now, my favorite director is probably James Cameron, just because almost everything he does is just good and big, but still good story, and not visual effects just for the sake of visual effects. You know, he's always has a compelling characters and story arc, and so yeah, he's he's my favorite. But there's a lot of, you know, people. Steven Spielberg certainly. Back then and still to this day, George Miller, Sam Raimi, Peter Jackson. I really like I'm not sure if I'm going to say it right. Denis Villeneuve directed the new recent Dune movie and Blade Runner 2052, I believe was the
2049.
Yeah. 2049, something like that. Yeah.
So, branching off, what's your favorite movie to watch then that like gets you, maybe you just really need the juices going, you're like, I need some inspiration, like I'm feeling like I need a solid film, what's your like go-to?
It changes. Some of the ones that pop in my head would be Mad Max Fury Road.
Yes,
I really love that movie. It's just the visual storytelling with that one. I just love it. Terminator 2.
Okay.
All three Lord of the Rings movies. Probably Return of the King, Return of the Jedi. That's my favorite of the original Star Wars movies. I know I'm in the minority with that one, but
it's really good. That's understandable.
Yeah, it's kind of the
I'm with you.
The payoff, if you will, for the previous
one. Yes. Plus I love the Emperor so much in that.
So are you holding out for Avatar since James Cameron's kind of your guy?
Yeah, I know. I mean, am I wanting right now, like, I don't know, four more Avatar movies? Not really. I'd like him to do some other stuff, but I think he's earned the ability to make whatever he wants. And if he thinks it's going to be good, he hasn't let me down. So it'll probably be good.
But you got to think, like, that movie, like the first one, and whatever the second one is, whenever that happens, is going to look vastly different, don't you think?
I would imagine. I mean, and he must have ideas about what he wants to do with it if he's embarking on this thing. And
right. And it's usually his cycle, like 7-8 years between films.
Yeah, I mean, you could have said the same with, you know, The Terminator was a great movie, and you could have said, well, do we really need another one? And then Terminator 2 is, I mean, one of the best films of all time.
True.
I will admit, I've never seen it. I've seen
you need to change that tonight.
I think I've seen two of them. I saw the newest one. I remember it with, like, the chick and the stuff and the whatever. Which I clearly remember a lot of. And then the one with like Christian Bale and Sam Worthington.
I think. I mean, those are perfectly watchable, but they're not, you need to watch Terminator 2. I mean, it holds up. It really holds up.
I'll
It
have to add
does.
that to my list.
And Dark Fate picks up at the end of Terminator 2 in a way. So,
You know, I don't think I've seen that one. I think I don't think I
yeah.
saw it. So we all have
Since it had
homework.
Linda Hamilton. So,
Yeah.
well, I
Yeah.
don't. I've seen
Come
them.
on, Alan.
So you make films here in Minnesota, David. So I guess what do you love about making films here?
Definitely filming in winter is the best thing about Minnesota. Now, when you try to do something outdoors in winter, you realize why they shoot a lot of stuff in California and Georgia. But that being said, there's a lot of talent here. And I think there's also a good community of other filmmakers who support each other. And so that the community aspect of it, and then just that we have all this talent that we can draw from here, I think is what's fun about Minnesota. And I think less facetiously, the cold weather and the variety of weather and landscape makes for some interesting opportunities as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that makes sense. I mean, you can really shoot anything here, even if it's not fun because you're freezing for 16 hours a day. But you still have the opportunity, and then it's real. Like you can tell that it's real cold rather than like they're actually standing in 90 degree heat but pretending to be cold.
Fake movie snow usually doesn't look very good. So, yeah, get the real stuff here.
So, have you made films outside of Minnesota?
Well, my high school films were in South Dakota, Sioux Falls.
Okay.
And I
Counts.
did, while I was in school, I did make, or and I'm a couple things in Iowa, but that's about it. I mean, the Midwest.
Do you have much of a desire to branch out to other states or like territories, for landscape or environment, community?
I mean, I like Minnesota. I probably will keep working, or my regular job is here, and my family is, we've put down roots here. I think probably stay here. But I mean, I if I had the opportunity to, someone was going to pay me to go to California and make a movie, I wouldn't turn them down.
Absolutely.
But I, for now, I plan on staying here.
It's understandable.
Yeah. What do you look forward to the most when you start a new project or film?
Showing it to an audience, I would say, completing it.
Oh, you like that, huh?
If you're asking about like the process of actually making it, though, the parts I probably like the most would be writing and then the editing and visual effects part. I think part of that's just because those are the things that you have some time, because once the thing I when I'm on set, I feel very under a time crunch, like I need to keep things moving, and it's kind of a high stress set. I mean, I don't know, depends on your schedule, but that's not as relaxing, I should say. Not my favorite part of the process. It's fun, but it's not, it's more pressure at that time.
So then what's the biggest challenge? Is that maybe the biggest challenge for you when you go to make a film, or is there something else that maybe like trumps that?
For me, it's probably the logistical aspects of getting everybody's schedule together and locations. So I'm, this is sort of a side hobby, passion project for me, the filmmaking. And so I don't, it's, I don't know, it's tough for me to find locations and I think have the credibility to just walk up and say, "Hey, can I shoot in your location?" And they'll say, "Well, who are you?" And I'll say, "Well, you can check out my website."
Here's
And
my card.
yeah, but yeah, and I guess, yeah, so that aspect of it, figuring out all that sort of stuff ahead of time is the biggest challenge for me. Let's see.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of filmmakers probably feel that way, honestly. Like the schedules in general, just trying to align everything and what's available to shoot in for locations in that small time frame is, I don't envy the people that have to make those decisions at all.
So what's next for you, David? Are you working on anything? Yeah. No?
Yeah, I'm probably gonna do something for ZFest this year. I'm sure. Well, I also hopefully have a project with Louis Anderson that's gonna come about eventually. There was the ZFest had a script competition that Louis Anderson graciously offered to select one and potentially be in it, you know, offer his time, which is pretty amazing and generous of him to do. But shortly after he announced that, or around the time that it was announced, and I feel fortunate that he selected my script for that, was right when the pandemic was coming in and the lockdown started happening. And so I've had some communication with his agent, but it's just kind of on ice at the moment because of the situation. So hopefully that will still happen. But it's just on hold at the moment. So I'm working with some folks to try to keep that moving, but it's just, he's not here. He's in Las Vegas. And I don't know. It's just kind of up in the air. Hopefully it will still happen, but
hopefully.
Yeah.
That's showbiz, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pandemics.
Yeah. I'm also helping write some scripts for the Lori Rubers was on your show a couple episodes past, and the web series that she's working on developing, I'm helping write a couple of the scripts for that. So
you're on the writing team.
Sweet. That's awesome.
Yeah with Brian Michael is heavily doing a lot of the other writing and kind of spearheading that thing, directing I believe as well. So
that's very exciting. Cool. Yeah.
Love it. So David, where can people find your work? Like, they want to watch your stuff. They want to see these alien videos now. So where can they, you mentioned a website.
Yes. It's willfixitinpostproductions.com.
I love that.
Every time I see that at ZFest, I'm like, oh, that's David's film. Here we go.
That's fantastic.
Tell me about that. Please tell us about that.
Well, I mean, it's a long-running, joke on set. Well, it doesn't start off as a joke. You know, just fix things in post that you really should have fixed in prep or on set. Yeah, so it's just, a saying that gets said a lot. One of my friends and actors, since even back in high school, he's been in some of my more recent ones as well, Aaron Piplow, he would frequently say, we'll fix it in post for things that obviously could not be fixed in post. And then Adam and I decided to use that as our business name, quote unquote business. We're not really a money-making operation. Decided to use that as our title. So we can see a lot of the more recent things there, not really our old stuff, because like I said, we just used movie soundtracks. So there's a lot of problems with just putting those up on YouTube. And so contact me if you want to really want to see them.
Well, and how do people what if somebody wants to work with you now? How do they get a hold of you?
Shoot me an email or message me on. So our email's on there. It's just, I should double check what that is. I think it's, I believe it's We'll Fix It in Post Productions at Gmail. I'll double check here. That's probably just the easiest way, or if through Facebook. We have a Facebook page for them. Yeah, we'll fix it in postproductions at gmail.com, or through our Facebook page would be another way as well. Collaborating is something I want to do a lot more of, because I'd like to not do everything for the things that I've worked on, and I'd like to work with a lot of people in the community, whether it's just being a PA or helping with script writing is probably my biggest strength, and anything else people need, I'll be a sound guy, whatever.
Anything.
Yeah, and I'm adding you to my world building, so to speak. And so, Rahana, I'm designing this world for this upcoming film project, but David had generously volunteered his name, so to speak, but I asked him, so I can't believe we did this, but he's supposed to be like a Calvin Klein in this world, but his initials are DM, so it's like for his name. But I don't know if you want to use your real name. I guess, you know, we could. I mean, I'll leave that up to you. I don't know what you think about that, David.
I don't know the full extent of what my character would, or my persona would be in this world fully yet. So maybe I'll regret lending my name to it. But
that picture you sent me is so perfect. It's just like, I sent him a picture of the only picture I could find of Calvin Klein online, which is weird.
I don't think I've ever seen a picture of him.
A good one, you know, like a headshot. But then I sent it to David, and somehow he got the picture kind of like just right for that. It's just like this headshot that I guess I can share it through our social media and such, but to compare the two when you look at them.
I've never done a photo like that before, but yeah, my wife helped me out, and we set up a light and did that.
Well, the idea is like everyone wears a designer name, and in this world, some people value that. So it's like, that'd be kind of fun to interject a made up designer name like that. So
love that.
Yeah.
It's funny because design is something, so as far as clothing and fashion, that's definitely something I know nothing about and I'm terrible at. You can ask my teenage daughters about my fashion sense.
It's like, how are you a brand name in this movie, Dad? You know? It's like, see, I know something.
Yeah, because I'm awesome, you're welcome.
Yeah.
That's the answer. I love that.
So, David, have you worked in any feature film work?
No, not really. There was kind of a lull in my filmmaking when I was in school and stuff. And so I wrote some screenplay. I wrote two feature screenplays just to kind of practice and see if I could do it. And I'm happy with them. But I don't think they're really something that could get made nowadays. One of them was a zombie apocalypse film
get made.
Well,
especially in Minnesota. We love our like zombie horror film stuff. Well,
okay, so maybe someone listening to this will take a bite. But the concept is that there's kind of two groups living in sort of remote rural or remote wooded area. One group is a bunch of gun nuts, and the other group is a bunch of sort of vegan living off the land hippies. And there's a zombie apocalypse, and those two groups need to come together and put their differences, you know, apart and value each other's contributions to survival in a post-apocalyptic zombie-filled world. So
that's good.
It was entitled Cold Dead Hands was the name of that one.
I like that.
So you wrote a draft of that, or
what's that?
You wrote a draft for that, or what?
Yeah, it's a 100 page screenplay for that. But
yeah, I feel like you could definitely get that made here. Well, you would have a lot of fun with that.
It'd be fun. I don't know. Zombies, you know, I was a fan of zombie films before they became really cool. So I'm a zombie hipster, as it were. But It's just kind of oversaturated, I think, since Walking Dead came about. So I don't know.
Yeah.
And then they spun off Walking Dead, and then there's more Walking Dead. And
there's no shortage of zombie much. Content at this point. So
that's true.
That ship has probably sailed. But yeah, I you know, my wife, her guilty pleasure is these cheesy Christmas movies.
Yeah.
So part of me, and I've, you know, tuned in for as much as I can handle, and they are very, you know, the budgets on those is pretty low. And I think, you know, with the right, I think someone can make a clever Christmas movie in Minnesota that could maybe get made.
Yeah, totally.
I feel like that's brilliant and it needs to happen. Because good Christmas movies are like hard to come by, but if you do it right,
You wouldn't need to have a huge budget, but you could make something actually pretty good, I think. So that's one thought.
Yeah.
Love that idea. That's exciting.
We could do one every year. So
pretty much. The other idea I would like to consider would be like a get together with various Minnesota filmmakers and do a horror anthology of some sort, you know, so then it's not too big for any one thing. And I love horror anthologies. So.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. That's a really cool idea. I love it. So you mentioned, we've actually never had somebody bring up Christmas films on here before. So love that idea, that concept. And we know probably 90% of the people that we've had on are like, horror movies, is there anything that you haven't done, like any genre you maybe haven't outside of Christmas, dipped your toe into that you would actually like to maybe eventually give a shot at?
I think my, you know, as you could tell from the films and directors that I mentioned, science fiction is probably the genre that I like the most. And I've kind of dabbled in some science fiction comedy shorts. So something in that area, maybe a more legitimate sort of serious quote unquote, not comedy. I probably always have some comedic elements in anything I do, but you know, a more dramatic science fiction piece would be something I'd want to try to do.
I like that.
With the comedy. I like that. Yeah. That seems like you've had some of those comedic parts in your Z Fest films, I've noticed. And yeah.
Love it. All right. Well, David, we have one final, like the big question for you. What do you want people to most remember about you?
This is a tough question. So
it is.
I'm going to be very vague with it and just say, he was a nice guy and did some good stuff. So
I love that. 100%.
Have you seen Succession?
I have not.
Okay.
It's on my short list of things I need to get to watch to be part of the zeitgeist, but yeah.
Okay.
I also have not seen it. So
I'm trying to get people to watch it, so I have people to talk to about it, but that's fine.
Someday. I mean, it only took me 33 years to watch E.T., so I mean, I'm getting close. I'll take less time to watch Succession.
You know, there's a lot of movies that I, you know, I'm sure I should have seen that I haven't. But we all have those areas.
Or
gaps to fill.
There's only so much time.
Exactly.
Right. Even if you love film.
Especially like if you're making films, because then you're busy making them, you know.
So, right. Yeah. And most of us have, you know, regular jobs and other responsibilities as well. So,
but anyways. Yeah, I distracted from the whole you want to be remembered thing. It nice just reminded me of a speech that was given in Succession. So anyways.
Well, David, it was awesome getting to talk to you and getting to know you a bit. Thank you so much for taking the time out to hang out with us and let us pick your brain.
Yes, thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it. And honored to be here amongst so many other great filmmakers and actors in the community. And yeah, I'd like to collaborate with any and everybody if they are so interested.
Absolutely. Awesome. All right. And until next time, thanks, listeners. This is Film in Minnesota.